the epistles taken upon St. Paul's letter to the Corinthians, first letter, chapter 11. Brethren, I received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you. The Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread and giving thanks, broke and said, "Take it, eat. This is my body, which shall be delivered for you. This do for the commemoration of me." In like manner also the chalice after he had supped, saying, "This chalice is the new testament in my blood. This do ye as often as you shall drink for the commemoration of me." And as often as you shall eat this bread and drink the chalice, you shall show the death of the Lord until he come. Therefore, whosoever shall eat this bread or drink the chalice of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the blood of the body and the blood of the Lord. But let a man prove himself. Let him eat of that bread and drink of the chalice. He that eateth and drinketh unworthily eateth and drinketh judgment unto himself, not discerning the body of the Lord. Please stand for the gospel. The gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ is taken from St. John chapter 6. At that time Jesus said to the multitude of the Jews, "My flesh is meat indeed, and my blood is drink. He that eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood abideth in me, and I in him. As the living Father hath sent me, and I live by the Father, so he that eateth me, the same also shall live by me. This is the bread that came down from heaven. I was your father to eat manna and departed. He that eateth this bread shall live forever." Please be seated. Dear faithful, my apologies for not making it here in time for confessions, but with the length of the drive today with all the traffic, it took us close to 3 hours. And also because of the procession, I couldn't leave any earlier to make up for that time. We had to skip the confessions this evening, afternoon. But this afternoon, after Mass, we do have the benediction, because this is Corpus Christi. I hope you will make use of this benediction. Stay in the presence for it. I also want to remind you of the ordinations of priests coming up on Friday. That will be the Feast of the Sacred Heart. Those three young men will be ordained to the priesthood on Feast of the Sacred Heart in Dillaway, Virginia. St. Thomas Aquinas. Reverend Mr. Delalo, Reverend Mr. Hart, and Reverend Mr. Steele. Also, I want to remind the men about the Day of Recollection, like a mini retreat that we're putting together, two conferences by myself. So I hope that you'll get registered. I think about 9 of you men are registered so far. Hope you make good use of that also at the ladies' day. Please check out the information. Next weekend, we're a little bit on the diaspora or something like that. We will not be able to have Mass here because of another planned event from the hotel. So we will be notifying you where that will be. It's just for this coming Sunday. Unfortunately, it is the external solemnity of the Sacred Heart, so I hope you've heard that well. The Sacred Heart that we have to uproot ourselves for Sunday. All the more reason to find a more permanent location. Of course, we're not ready to buy, outwardly buy a piece of property, so we'll have to look into a long-term lease so that we can call it our own, that we get such the signs of faithful or money saved in order to actually own a property. Don't know if that's a good thing or a bad thing to save so many things, but I did did say in articles that I thought they were very important for education and for our own edification, maybe even for your instruction. So I used one of them today, and it's an email actually that was written, sent to me years ago by another man, a friend of mine. And this teacher wrote this for him to explain why he would never teach in a public school again. And I bring it up today because I love the tenacity, stalwartness of this story, of this little girl who this teacher is talking about. And that's why she would never teach in a public school again. And we'll connect that to this in this short sermon. I'm sorry, a short sermon. She says, we were reading some chapter in history text, and I call on students here and there to read a paragraph just to keep them on their toes. Of course, all the history books have been changed. There is no BC and AD nowadays. It's BCE and CE. So eventually I call on one little girl, and she starts to read, and then she gets to a time reference. And instead of reading the year plus BCE or CE as is written in the text, she substitutes BC and AD. And all the other kids went ballistic. Mrs. Schaefer, she's not allowed to do that. Make her read it the right way. Our teacher doesn't allow her to do that. This substitute. Contempt they felt for this little girl was so intense, it was painful to me. I just wanted to cry for her. Then she stands up tall and says, quote, my mother told me that I should always read it this way, so I always will. And the teacher's in shock at her boldness. What a mother she must have. All the kids continue to ridicule her and demand that I reprimand her. I'm thinking, oh my, I should have passed with this assignment this morning. Could be that this could have gone real nasty. But ultimately, the teacher talked to the girl and found out she was a Christian. And the girl, of course, said, are you a Christian, to the teacher? Because the teacher is very sympathetic to her. So the teacher at that moment took an opportunity to explain. But you can't get away from it. She at least laid out for the class that there's something that happened in time that doesn't matter whether you call it, well, BCE or CE or AD or BC. Something happened in time you can never forget. You'll never get away from it. And it's the birth of our Lord. His incarnation. I don't care if you're an atheist or what, you cannot get away from it. No matter how you rewrite it. Yes. Here we are today, dear faithful, to worship our Lord. Come to Mass, to adore Him, and the Blessed Sacrament. And we can't get away from it. You know, you can be the most pious, holy Catholic, or the worst atheist, and both have to admit that something happened. Both cannot get away from the fact that Jesus is something instrumental, something influential in society. So you embrace it or you don't. God bless this little girl. So my mother told me that I should always read it this way, and so I will. He is willing to embrace Him. And the reality is that the incarnation of our Lord and His presence amongst us is impacting society. Blessed Sacrament, our Lord Jesus Christ present among us for 2,000 plus years now, has changed the world. I wish I had more time to talk about how that's so, but you know it. Look at history. Look at the cathedrals and churches that were built because of this reality. Yes, Jesus incarnate, which quote unquote, I suppose you could say some Protestants believe that. But would they go to such lengths to build a church where you can worship, yes, the center of it all, which is the tabernacle? And in the tabernacle is Jesus. Who goes to those lengths of those who believe? That, of course, brings you around to the story that some of you may have heard before, because I've certainly told it at least a few years ago. I think I remember saying it in the North Chapel in one of my sermons, the story of Father Burfitt, who was in the islands of the Pacific and ended up being kidnapped by the Japanese. Finally, this poor island, which had been left out of the world wars and any difficulties, missionaries could just do their work there, and suddenly, unfortunately, the Japanese found them. So they stuck their nose into Father Murphy's business and said, "Well, Father Murphy, making false promises." They said, "Come with us, we'll give you medicine that you need for these people." And they lied. They took them away and they killed them. The people didn't know that. They saw him go, "There he goes." Father Murphy, when will you be back? He says, "Well, they tell me we'll be back tomorrow, or maybe this evening, whatever it was." And they watched for a day, 8 days. What turned into a week turned into months, and what turned into, well, from months turned into a couple of years. He never came back, Father Murphy. Sacred Heart Father, missionary. But you know what those poor people did because they believed? I don't say poor because they're somehow deficient. I say they're poor because they lost their shepherd. But what they did have was great faith. So they taught catechism. The catechists got up and they taught catechism every Sunday. They kept the church clean. They kept everything as though Father Murphy would appear on the spot at any moment to offer mass. Did, of course. They kept going. They baptized the babies that were necessarily that needed to be baptized, and then they waited for Father Murphy for the big sacraments. Finally, a boat came up the river into the middle of the island. There was a prelate there. They thought it might be Father Murphy, but no, it turned out to be the bishop. And the bishop arrived. He saw what enthusiasm these people had. He was so taken back that Father Murphy had done such good work with them. He was so full of faith after being shepherdless for these couple of years. He said, "Oh, Your Excellency, where is Father Murphy? We were waiting for him." So, "Oh, my dear people, I think that the Japanese took him away and murdered him." Oh, they were devastated. Devastated. Then I said, "Well, the most important thing for me to do is obviously to go to the church and check it out and see what they're doing. How is the setup, the things of the mass, the things of the altar?" And he found them all clean, everything in order. And then the real telling question: what happened to the hosts that were in the tabernacle? This is the Pacific. This is not nice California. The weather is terrible, humid, muggy. Well, Murphy used to have to change out the hosts every week to make certain that they weren't soggy, moldy, or worm-ridden. It happens. The hosts can easily start to decompose with that type of weather. We priest know. He opens the tabernacle with the key. Perfect. It yellowed a little bit. They were not decomposed. The real presence was there. After all of that time. Yes. That's a miracle. But that's a miracle for those poor people. And I say poor again, not because they're deficient, but simply God left his presence there, protected the hosts for the good of those souls. So it's a great, great story of inspiration for us priests, of course, and hopefully for all of you in the real presence and our Lord's presence. Our faith in him is and can be incredible. It's a gift. It's his body and soul, his blood, his body and his soul, his divinity. It's a gift to us in this little vessel, in this little vehicle. One last thing to say, something you could actually, if you wish, hear a longer sermon about it, you can look at the recorded sermon and listen to it from earlier today. You must keep this short. You know, recently we had some good winds against the governor's state of California. These things have come to be settled. You know, what's important for us to remember is why. Why are we free? Why do we have liberty? Let us keep our priorities straight. It is first to adore God. It is first to give him his due. That's why we fought. Because if it didn't matter, then of course the priority goes to the salon, where you could have your nails done and your hair done, and you couldn't go to church. If the priority is getting food for the body, and not food for the soul, then of course you go to the Walmart. Of course it's open. It's not a Catholic's thinking. Catholic's thinking is God first. The priority is God. And if God is closed down, why would we want the rest? So we thought, now we hope to preserve our freedom for one purpose. To honor God, as Pope Leo XIII says. Law is a prerequisite for genuine freedom. Pope Leo's reasoning is plain. If freedom meant the captivity to choose anything at all, including evil, then God and the blessed angels would not be free. For whosoever commits sin is a slave of sin. John chapter 8, verse 34. When man acts according to reason, quote, he acts of himself and according to his free will, and this is liberty. Whereas when he sins, he acts in opposition to reason, and is moved by another, and becomes the victim of foreign misapprehensions. Freedom is the unimpeded capacity to fulfill our God-ordained end, which is what? To love him, to seek his justice, heaven. The eternal God is the sole standard and the rule of human liberty. So here we are today to worship our Lord, to worship him in the Blessed Sacrament. We are free to do so, and that right will always and should always be protected. And they're faithful. If you have to fight for it, you fight for it. Archbishop Burfitt, he was obedient, schismatic, blackball bishop. Okay? That's what we can say about him. And how can any one of us ever stand up for what's wrong, what wars against our religion? We cannot do that. We have to stand up for what's right, what's the truth. Especially when it comes to our relationship with God. How we're free and we're always and should always be free to express it. As Catholics, you need to be able to do that. You need to be able to say that. You need to be able to fight for it. And I'm sorry, then everybody else, yes. I know that everybody, every other religion should have a similar right, yes. But you know what? Ultimately, no. Because I just told you it's according to truth. He who is free is the one who seeks after truth. Not just anything. So if the Catholics don't lead the way, who will? So here we are at the door of our Lord in the Blessed Sacrament, both at Mass, here for the Communion, and at the benediction. Thank our Lord that you're free to do so. And ask that he may, there may never be a day that you're not able to freely worship him. And bless the sacrament. What a gift. Father Murphy thought so. So did the young people. So do we. I think of Blessed Virgin Mary, Our Lady of the Blessed Sacrament, that she can help me to adhere to our Lord, stay close to him. That he may say, like a little girl, my mother told me that I should always read it this way. So I always will. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost.